morning, students. Today, I will be continuing with the control stability, the stability analysis problems. So, in the last class, we came across condition wherein we were able to decide whether the system was stable or unstable by looking into the elements of the first column of the root array table. So, if the elements of the elements or if all the elements of the first column are positive and non-zero, then we say that the system is stable. In case if there are some negative elements in the first column, then the number of sign changes will tell you how many poles are on the right hand side of the S plane, and we come to a conclusion that the system is unstable. So always remember, even if you have a single pole on the right hand side, the system becomes unstable. So for a stable system, all the poles should lie on the left hand side of the S plane. And apart from that, we also came across a condition wherein you had a row of all zeros. So whenever you have a row of all zeros, you have to keep in mind that you will have at least one pair of poles, on the imaginary axis. And that is dependent on the auxiliary equation you write. So instead of explaining what we do there, I'll just take one more problem and explain you the concept. So always remember, whenever you get a row of all zeros, then it means that the system will be either unstable or it will be marginally stable, and the number of poles on the imaginary axis will be decided by the degree of the auxiliary equation. I repeat again, auxiliary equation is an even polynomial. So coming on to the problem, let me continue with this new problem today. So you can see that it is given that a feedback control system has a characteristic equation given by this. You have to find out how many poles are on the left hand side of the S plane and how many you have on the imaginary axis and how many poles you have on the right hand side of the S plane. So first thing you have to observe here is, since the degree of the characteristic equation is 6, there are totally 6 poles. Among those 6 poles, you have to identify how many are on the left hand side, how many are on the imaginary axis, and how many are on the right hand side. It doesn't mean that it has to always be in all the places. So depending on the problem, we can decide it later. So now, once we have the characteristic equation, we can very easily write the prepare the first two rows of the table. So you can see the characteristic equation here. It has coefficients 1, 2, 9, 16, 24, 32, 16. So I have written as 1, 2, 9, 16, 24, 32, 16. So you have to start with the highest degree s to the power of 6, and then you have to go up to s to the power of 0. But when you do the problem, you can see first two rows you have prepared. So you could have written one more row, s to the power of 5. This row, s to the power of 5, is divisible by 2. So you could have simplified that and you could have written it as 1, 8 and 16 if you divide this entire row by 2. So just to show that even if without dividing that, you can solve the problem, I've just written it as it is. So the option is yours. You can either simplify or, since you are using the calculator, you can do it by the usual method how you were doing earlier also without simplifying. So now s to the power of 4 row, you get it as 1, 8 and 16. And you know how to get this one. 2 into 9, 18. Minus 1 into 16 divided by 2. So it is 18 minus 16 divided by 2. 18 minus 16 is 2. 2 by 2 is 1. Similarly, 8. You can see here 2 into 24 minus 1 into 32 divided by 2. You get 8. Next, 2 into 16 minus 1 into 0 divided by 2. You get 16. So if you had simplified this, if you had divided this equation completely by 2, you would have got this as 1, 8 and 16. So whenever you get two rows which are similar, then obviously the next row will be a row of all zeros. In this problem, I have not done any simplification, but even when you calculate, you get the same thing. So you can just check the value for one value here. So this is 1 into 16 minus 2 into 8 is 16. 16 minus 16 divided by 1, you get a 0. Then 1 into 32 is 32. 32 minus 2 into 16 is 32. So 32 minus 32 by 1 is 0. So next one, 1 into 0 is 0 minus 2 into 0 is 0. So 0 minus 0 divided by 1 is 0. So in this case, you are able to get a row of all zeros. So always one thing you have to observe, as I said in the previous class, always the row of all zeros will always be the degree of the equation will always be an odd number. So either s to the power of 3 will be 0 or s to the power of 1 will be 0, like this. Because when you write the auxiliary equation is always an even polynomial. So you can observe that here, the degree of the row of all zeros, which I got a row of all zeros, the degree is always an odd number. So now, how do we write? Whenever you get a row of all zeros, you have to first write the auxiliary equation. So how do you write the auxiliary equation? By using the coefficients of the previous row. So the previous row is s to the power of 4 rho. So how do we write the auxiliary equation is? It is, since it is s to the power of 4, so it is 1 into s to the power of 4 plus 0 into s to the power of 3 plus 8 into s to the power of 4 plus 0 into s to the power of 1 plus 16 into s to the power of 0. Since we have a row of all zeros, 0 multiplied by something is 0. So I directly write the equation here as s to the power of 4 plus 8s squared plus 16. So you can see here all the degree of the auxiliary equation is an even number. 4, 2 and 0. It is an even number. So we say that the auxiliary equation is always an even polynomial. So after we have got the auxiliary equation, differentiate this equation with respect to s. You get 4s cubed plus 16s plus 0. So now you have to replace the row of zeros what you have here with the coefficients of the differentiated polynomial. The differentiated polynomial coefficients are 4 and 16. So just replace it by 4 and 16 in s cubed. So strike off that s cubed row and now prepare the table. I have retained from s power 6 to s to the power of 4, I have retained the same thing. And the next row, what I have done, I have replaced the row of all zeros by the coefficients of the differentiated polynomial. So I get 4 and 16 here. So now you can see here, this 4 and 16, you can either retain it as it is, or I can divide this equation by 4. Forget about the 0. Divide this equation by 4. So you get 1 and 4. If you want, this is an optional case. If you want, you do. Otherwise, retain it as the same form, original form, what you had earlier. So now, after I simplify this, so the arrow indicates that it is a simplified equation. So I get 1, 4 and 0. Next, s square. So when I want to find s square, always, whenever you have done the simplification, in pencil, strike this out. Strike this out. Otherwise, you may make a mistake by multiplying 1 into 16 minus 4 into 4 is 16 divided by 1, and then you write one more row of all zeros. So that mistake you should not do. So better strike this row in pencil, and now you have to consider the previous row. So that is 1 into 8 minus 1 into 4 divided by 1. So it is 8 minus 4 by 1, which is nothing but 4. Similarly, 1 into 16 minus 1 into 4 minus 16 minus 4 into 0 divided by 1. So you get the answer as 16. Similarly, likewise, you have to prepare the row of all zeros. So when you come to this s square row, you see that you have got 1 and 4. You have got 1 and 4. I think you can observe here. 1 and s square row. You have got 4 and 6, 4, 16 and 0. Then after simplification, you have divided that by 4. You got it as 1 and 1, 4, 0. And then when you evaluate s power 1. So s power 1, when you are evaluating, you have to see like which two rows you are multiplying. This is the simplified version what actually you are using here. So again, you see that you get s power 1 row as again 0. So whenever you get a row of all zeros, again you have to follow the same procedure. So one thing what you have to remember here is, it doesn't mean that for any problem given, it is not necessary that you should have only one auxiliary equation. You can have more than one auxiliary equation depending on the number of odd power of s you have. So now in the previous row we saw that s to the power of 3 became 0. Now again s power 1 became 0. So now you have to prepare the auxiliary equation using s square row. So the s square coefficients are 1, 4 and 0. So now use this and prepare the auxiliary equation. So since it is a new auxiliary equation, I am just rewriting this as a dash of s. So a dash of s will be s square plus 4 into s to the power of 0. Because auxiliary equation is always an even polynomial. So how did you get this auxiliary equation s square plus 4? So you can see here, this row what you have here, you can see the cursor here. So it is 1 into s square plus 0 into s power 1 plus 4 into s power 0 plus 0. So just if you eliminate these 0 terms, you get s square plus 4. When you differentiate that, you get 2s plus 0. Now you replace the row of all 0, that is s power 1 row with 2 and 0. So when you do that, you get the polynomial, you get the final table in this way. So when you observe here, you see that you get the elements as the last row as 4 and 0. Now, after you observe the elements here, what is that you see? You see that all the elements of the first column are positive and non-zero. But never come to a conclusion it is stable, because we had a row of all zeros. And always remember, whenever you have a row of all zeros, it indicates the presence of imaginary poles. So whenever you have imaginary poles, either the system will be marginally stable or it will be unstable. Now, how many poles are there on the imaginary axis? That is decided by the auxiliary equation. But in this problem, you see that you have two auxiliary equations. So the first auxiliary equation was this one, s power 4 plus 8 s square plus 16. And the second auxiliary equation, what you got was s square plus 4. You have two auxiliary equations. But to find the location of the poles on the auxiliary equation, use the auxiliary equation with the highest degree. So the one with the highest degree is the first equation, that is s to the power of 4 plus 8 s square plus 16. You can see it here. So whenever you have to find the location of the poles and the frequency of oscillations, you have to use the auxiliary equation with the highest degree. Now you replace s squared by x. So what is that you observe here? Since the auxiliary equation is of degree 4, it clearly indicates that the 4 poles will lie on the imaginary axis. So totally how many poles are there in this? There are totally 6 poles, and out of those 6 poles, 4 poles will lie on the imaginary axis. And now we have to see like where the remaining 2 will lie. So where the remaining 2 will lie, if you just see here, so before we go to that, let me complete this and then we'll come to this. So x auxiliary equation we have, I'm trying to write this in terms of x. I get x is equal to minus 4 minus 4, but x is equal to s square. S square is equal to minus 4. S square is equal to minus 4, I get. So s is equal to plus or minus j2. S is equal to plus or minus j2. So now you see that you have double pair of poles on the imaginary axis. So out of the 6 poles, 4 poles are on the imaginary axis. So when you see, when you have double pair of repeated poles on the imaginary axis, it means that the system is unstable. So out of the 6 poles, 4 poles are on the imaginary axis. Remaining 2 are on the LHS of the S-plane, because we see that there are no sign changes. So if there are sign changes in the root array table, only then we can say that there are poles on the right hand side. But if you see the final root array table here, you observe that all the elements of the first column are positive. There are no sign changes. So you do not have any poles on the right hand side. But at the same time, since you have double pair of imaginary poles, we say that the system is unstable. So this is one type of problem what we are supposed to see. So the next problem is very much similar to this. For the characteristic equation given, you have to determine the number of the roots with positive real parts. So it means that you have to find out how many poles will lie on the right hand side of the S plane. So for finding that, again we have to follow the same procedure. Prepare the table. You have got a row of all zeros. Prepare the auxiliary equation using s power 6. Differentiate that replace s power 5 over with the coefficients of this one of the differentiated polynomial, and then you have to prepare the table again. So after you prepare the table, let me show you. Since it is a very similar one, I'm not going in detail. So this is the final equation what you get. So out of the 7 poles what you had, we see that how many sign changes are there. So plus 3 to minus 1 sign change, minus to minus no sign change, minus to minus no sign change, minus to plus 1 sign change. So we see that out of the 7 poles, since there are 2 sign changes, 2 poles will lie on the right hand side of the S plane. In this problem, if you see, they have not asked you to find out whether the system is stable or unstable. They are only asking you to find how many poles are there with positive real parts. So there are only 2 poles lying to the right hand side of the S plane. Okay, students, are you able to hear me? Are you able to hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Quickly, all of you, write your name and USN, mark your attendance now. I'll give you 1 minute, mark your attendance. Type it in the chat box. So if you have not marked the attendance, mark it immediately. So only I'll be checking the time from 9:55 to 9:56. Only those who are present during the time, I will be giving them attendance. Otherwise, I'll be marking absent. Please do it fast. I'll just give you 1 minute. Sujit Kumari has left the meeting. Sameer Saurabh has left the meeting. Vishwita has left the meeting. See, whoever is leaving the meeting, everything is being recorded. So kindly do mark your attendance. Are you all done with the meeting? Is Soundarya Saurabh, he left the meeting now. Okay, now I'll stop marking the attendance. Let me continue with the next problem. Okay, let me go to the next case. So the next case is, so we came across a case wherein you had normal growth rate. That is, we came across two cases. The elements of the first column were either all positive or some elements were negative in that, but it was non-zero, the first case. The second case was, we had a row of all zeros. Now coming on to the third case, we see that if any element of the first row, if the first element of any row is zero and the other elements are maybe non-zero or at least one non-zero element is there. So this is just an example I've taken here. The first element is zero and at least one non-zero element you have among the other. Then what is it you're supposed to do? So in that case, you have to proceed in a different way. So what you are supposed to do is, you have the characteristic equation, prepare the table as it is. Now in the next step, whenever you come across a case wherein you have only the first element to be zero and at least one non-zero element you have among the other, then in that case, replace your S by 1 by Z in the characteristic equation given to you. So this is your characteristic equation. So now what you're supposed to do? Replace S by 1 by Z in the characteristic equation. So when I do that replacement, it will become become 1 by z to the power of 6 plus 1 by z power 5 plus 3 by 3 into 1 by z power 4 into 2 by 1 by z to the power of 3, 5 by z square plus 3 by z plus 1 is equal to 0. Now you can take LCM. So take the highest degree. The highest degree is z to the power of 6. Take that as the LCM. So you get the equation as 1 plus z plus 3z square, 2z cube plus 5z power 4 plus 3z square plus z power 6 is equal to 0. Z to the power of 6 into 0 is 0. So now rearrange the terms in the starting from the highest degree to the lowest. You get z square plus 3z power 5 plus 5z power 4 plus 2z cube plus 3z square plus z plus 1. Are you all there?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, what I've done is, I have rearranged the terms from the highest degree to the lowest degree. Now, what I'll do is, like how I prepared the root array table using the S terms, I will now prepare the root array table using the Z terms. That is what I'm supposed to do. The procedure will remain the same. So now you have the we have the coefficients here in terms of z here. So this is z power 6 plus 3z power 5 plus 5z power 4 2z cube plus 3z square plus z plus 1. So now using the coefficients, prepare the first two rows. After you prepare the first two rows, you get z power 4 row. You will follow the same procedure how you did earlier. And then when you get you can see here, you can either proceed using the fraction terms only, there is no need to simplify, or you can just multiply this equation completely by 3 and you can get into the decimal form, or you can retain the previous form also. So now when you are multiplying next, you have to multiply the one which I have marked, that is z power 4 row, with z power 5 row. So that is only for my reference I have kept. So whenever you are doing any simplification, you try to strike out the one which you are not using now. Otherwise, when you are doing calculation, you may go wrong. So better strike this row in pencil. Because when you do the calculation, this 13 into 2 minus 3 into 8 divided by 13, and it is not 13 into 8 by 3 minus 13 by 3 into 8 divided by 13. So if you are retaining this row as it is, there are chances that you will make mistake and finally you will get a row of all zeros in the next line. So because both of them are z power 4 row. So always remember, whenever you have two similar rows, only then you get a row of all zeros. But this is not what we need. This is the simplified version of the above equation. So strike this row and multiply z power 4 and consider these two rows for evaluating the z power 3 row. So after that, you get z cube row. Multiply this with 13 by 2 so that you get this. Or one thing what I say is, retain it as it is. Do not make any changes. Only the numbers might change here, but we are not interested in the numbers. We are interested only whether the number is positive or negative, or it is zero or a row of all zeros. That is what we are interested in. So don't worry about what number you get. So if you are simplifying, some of you might get one set of values. If you are not simplifying, you might get another set of values, but the final answer will always remain the same. So after you have completed the table, this is how the table will look like. So this is your table. So now if you observe the elements of the first column, so how many, we see that we have two negative elements. So how many sign changes are there? So whenever you have a negative number, immediately you should know it is an unstable system. Whether it is a row of all zeros or it is element, the first element is a zero or the normal form, whatever you had. So now let us see how many sign changes are there. Plus to plus, no sign change. Plus to plus, no sign change. No sign change. No sign change. No sign change here. From here, plus to minus, one sign change. Minus to minus, no sign change. Plus to minus, one more sign change. So totally you have two sign changes. So what does it indicate? Out of the six poles what you had, two poles will lie on the right hand side, since there are two sign changes, and therefore we come to a conclusion that the system is unstable. So this is what we are supposed to find out. So very quickly we'll just check into the other problem. So here we have five poles And among these five poles, we'll see like where the poles will lie. So if you just see this equation here, you get s cubed rho, the first element to be a zero, and at least one non-zero element among the other elements. So replace s by 1 by z in this equation. So when you do that, you get the equation this way. So now this is 1 by z power 5, 1 by z power 4, 2 by z cube, 2 by z square, e by z plus 5 is equal to 0. So now once you take the LCM, so it is 1 plus z plus 2z square plus 2z cube, 3z power 4 plus 5z 5 divided by z power 5 is equal to 0. Z power 5 multiplied by 0 is 0. So you get the characteristic equation. This is the numerator itself is the characteristic equation now. Arrange that in from the highest degree to the lowest degree. Now prepare the root array table. So after you have prepared the root array table, we see that one element is negative here among the elements of the first column. So how many sign changes are there here? So plus to plus, no sign change. Plus to minus, one sign change. Minus to plus, one sign change. Plus to plus, no sign change. Plus to plus, no sign change. So totally there are two sign changes happening here. Plus to minus, minus to plus. Therefore, since we have two sign changes happening, out of the five poles, two poles will lie on the right hand side of the S plane, and we come to a conclusion that the system is stable. So in case, after we do that, if we do not have any sign change, if all the elements are positive, then directly we can say that the system is stable. But you have to be very careful when you have a row of all zeros. When you have a row of all zeros, and if all the elements of the first column are positive, do not come to a conclusion it is stable, it is stable. You have to check where actually the poles will lie on the imaginary axis. So this also is a very simple case. So now since you have two sign changes, out of the five poles, two poles will lie on the right hand side of the S plane. So now going on to the next problem. You can see here, instead of giving you the characteristic equation directly, they have given you the open loop transfer function, that is g of s, h of s. They're asking you to find whether the system is stable. So if nothing is mentioned, assume that the system is having a negative feedback. So with that, we can find the transfer function, or directly we can find the transfer function. No need to find the closed loop transfer function. Directly find the characteristic equation, 1 plus g of s, h of s is equal to 0. Substitute for g of s, h of s. Simplify this equation. So this is your characteristic equation, what we have got. S squared plus 3s minus 1 is equal to 0. Prepare the array table, root array table. You see, plus to plus, no sign change. Plus to minus, one sign change. So it means that out of the two poles, one pole will lie on the right hand side and one pole will lie on the left hand side. Since one pole is on the right hand side, the system is unstable. So this is a very important problem. So like this, you can expect some problems. The exam, determine the range of K for stability of unity feedback system whose open loop transfer function is g of s is equal to K by s into s plus 1 into s plus 2. So they're telling this is the open loop transfer function of a unity feedback system. Unity means h of s is 1. Since nothing is mentioned, we'll assume it is negative feedback. You have to find the range of K for which the system is stable. So since g of s, h of s is known to you, you need not have to prepare the open loop, the closed loop transfer function. Directly you can move on to this. So directly, instead of doing all that stuff, directly you can find the characteristic equation. G of s, h of s is known to you. 1 plus g of s, h of s is equal to 0. Substitute for g of s, h of s. Take the LCM, simplify, you get the characteristic equation like this. So I have done two steps extra here. So this is actually not required, but after doing only I got to know that. So better you may not have to do this. To simplify your problem, directly start with 1 plus g of s, h of s is equal to 0. Substitute for g of s, h of s. G of s is given, h of s is 1. So substitute in this equation, simplify, you get the characteristic equation. Now you prepare the root array table. So you, if you observe the root array table, you observe that one coefficient here is k, is a variable k, but we don't know what is that k. So you are supposed to find for what value of k the system will be stable. Prepare the root array table in terms of k. So coefficient of s cube is 1, coefficient of s square is 3, so 1, 3, 2, coefficient of s power 0 is k, so write k. The next row will be 3 2s are 6, 6 minus 1 into k is k, 6 minus k divided by 3. Next one is 0, and the next element here will be 6 minus k by 3 into k minus 0 divided by 6 minus k by 3, so you get the answer as k. Now, you have to find out for what value of k the system is stable. So, in order to find for what value of k the system is stable, so we know that for a system to be stable, all the elements of the first column should be positive, and it should be positive or it should be greater than 0. Only then we say it is positive. If it is greater than 0, we say it is positive. 1 is greater than 0, 3 is greater than 0. So, the other condition is that 6 minus k by k should be greater than 0 and k also should be greater than 0. So for a system to be stable, since all the elements should be greater than 0, I have written the condition here 6 minus k by k is greater than 0 and k is greater than 0. So 6 minus k is greater than 0, k is less than 6, so if k is greater than 0 or 0 is less than k. Now if I combine these two, 0 less than k, less than 6. So the condition is that for a system to be stable, the value of k should lie between 0 and 6. So this is a very important problem which was asked in the exam. Coming on to the next one, find the range of k for stability. So very similar to the previous one. Here g of s is given to you, h of s is equal to 1, negative feedback. So now you decide to find the characteristic equation. Or you can, what I have done is, I have found the overall transfer function, then the denominator polynomial I have taken. Or directly you do one thing, directly you find out the characteristic equation, which is 1 plus g of s, h of s. So g of s, h of s is 1. So characteristic equation is 1 plus g of s is equal to 0. Substitute, you get the characteristic equation. Now prepare the root array table, as I said you in the previous problem. So after you prepare the table, you get it like this again. For the system to be stable, all the elements of the first column should be greater than 0. So it means this element should be greater than 0 and k should be greater than 0. So now in order to satisfy that condition, 16 minus 8 minus 5k is greater than 0, or 16 minus 8 is greater than 5k, or k is less than 16.8 by 5, which indicates 60k is less than 3.36. Next condition, k should be greater than 0 or 0 is less than k. Combine the two cases and you can write the ranges 0 less than k less than 3.36. So for the system to be stable, k should lie between 0 and 3.36. Moving on to the next one. So are you all there, students? Students, are you there?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So these problems are all very simple. I'll just circulate the material to you by the end of the day. So you can just go through that. In case if you have any doubts, you can call me or you can mail me. I'll just clarify your doubts. So moving on to the next problem. So we see that this is an examination question problem. A system oscillates with a frequency omega radians per second. So immediately you have to remember, when will the system oscillate with some frequency? Whenever you have a row of all zeros. That you have to keep in mind. And you have to remember, whenever the poles will lie on the imaginary axis, the system will oscillate with some constant frequency, and that frequency is nothing but omega. They are telling that the system oscillates with a frequency omega radians per second, and the poles are at s is equal to plus or minus j omega. And they are also telling that no poles in the right hand side of the S plane. There are no poles on the right hand side. So no poles on the right hand side means that they are indirectly telling that the system, we cannot come to a conclusion that the system is unstable. Then they are telling, determine the value of k and small a so that the system shown in the figure will oscillate at a frequency 2 radians per second. So we have to find out the value of k and a so that the system will oscillate at frequency omega is equal to 2 radians per second. So this is the block diagram that is given. H of s is 1, g of s is this block what is given to you. Find the characteristic equation. So in the characteristic equation, what I have done? I have substitute it for G of s, H of s. H of s is 1. So take the LCM and simplify. Denominator multiplied by 0 is 0. So now you get the equation like this. So you get s cube plus a s square. You have 2s, ks. So take s common outside and write 2 plus k into s. And then 1 plus k is equal to 0. Prepare the root array table now. So after you prepare the root array table using the coefficients, see s cube, s square, s power 1, s power 0, all the terms are there. Some term is missing. For example, if s to the s term is missing, that will be 0. So that you have to be very careful. Before starting with the problem, just observe if all the elements of the s, the whether all the degrees of s are present. If it is s cube should be there, s square should be there, s1 should be there, s power 0 should be there. After you prepare the root array table, now what is it they're telling? They said that the system is oscillating at some particular frequency, 2 radians per second. So whenever the system oscillates at some frequency, you should know that there is a row of all zeros. First 2 rows, you prepared it using the elements what you have from the characteristic equation. So the row, you should now find out which row should become 0. So since you are left with only these 2 rows, always the row with an odd degree of s will always be 0. So obviously s power 1 row only should become equal to 0. So for a system to oscillate, this s power 1 row should become equal to 0. For this to become 0, this is already 0 second term. The first term also should become equal to 0. So for the first term to become 0, so I will tell here the first term to become 0, this is equal to 0. I get a as 1 plus k by 2 by k. And it is also said that once you have a row of all zeros, you can easily find the auxiliary equation. So now if I get my s power 1 row as a row of all zeros, then s square row, I can find the auxiliary equation using s square row. So that is nothing but a s square plus 1 plus k is equal to 0. So now a s square plus 1 plus k is equal to 0. A s square is equal to minus of 1 plus k. A square is minus 1 by 1 plus k by a. And s is equal to plus or minus j root of 1 plus k by a. So this is nothing, it is of the form plus or minus j omega. So your omega is nothing but this term under the root here. So now in the problem it is given that the system oscillates at 2 radians per second. Substitute for omega as 2. 2 is equal to root of 1 plus k by a. Square both the sides, you get 4 is equal to 1 plus k by a. So find out a. A is 1 plus k by 4. But a, earlier we have just now found out what is a. A is 1 plus k by 2 plus k. Substitute for that value. So substitute for that value a. So you get 1 plus k by 2 by k is equal to 1 plus 4 by 4. Just go up and show you. So squaring both sides, you got this. A is equal to this. I substituted for a from equation 1. I got this equation. Numerators will get cancelled. So denominators I can equate. 2 plus k is equal to 4. So k I get it as equal to 2. Once I get the value of k, I can easily find the value of a. This which is 1 plus k by 4. It is 3 by 4. So this is a very important question which was asked twice or thrice in the university examination. So students, with this I will come to the end of today's class. By the end of the day, there are some more portions that is left out to be written. I'll just write that and then circulate the material to you. So with that, half the module will come to an end. So in the next class,
ma'am left the class.